Well, good morning to wherever and whenever you're watching this webinar. I'm Jacob Baxter, a PhD candidate at the University of St. Andrews, and today I'm going to talk to you about the English diplomat and author Sir William Temple. I'd be more than happy to answer any questions that arise from this presentation. Don't hesitate to get in touch via the contact details on the slide. I'm going to begin with a Scotsman who's far away from home. In the summer of 1763, a young ambitious man by the name of James Boswell went to the Dutch Republic. He spent the first few months at the University of Utrecht, where he'd gone to study law, battling with depression. As he made clear in a letter to one of his friends, he was rather reluctant to describe his new surroundings. "I have no room to write you remarks on this country. In the meantime, I would have you read Sir William Temple's observations. They are short and entertaining, and will give you some idea of the country where your friend is." Boswell's mood gradually improved, helped in no part by a whirlwind romance. Eventually, he plucked up the courage to describe the Dutch Republic in another letter, and I'm afraid the news was not good. In such circumstances, this trading nation must be in a very bad way. Most of their principal towns are sadly decayed, and instead of finding every mortal employed, you meet with multitudes of poor creatures who are starving in idleness. You see then that things are very different here from what most people in England imagine. Were Sir William Temple to revisit these provinces, he would scarcely believe the amazing alteration which they have undergone. As Boswell made clear in his letters, the Dutch Golden Age, the age of Rembrandt, the age of Vermeer, and unparalleled economic prosperity had well and truly faded. And yet to demonstrate this, he referred to a man who had been dead for over 60 years and his most famous book, which was almost a century old. Today, I'm going to introduce you to the English diplomat and author, Sir William Temple, the man at the centre of my PhD research, and show you how both Ebo and Ebe have been pivotal in my work. After a brief biographical sketch, I'm going to introduce you to two of Temple's books, both of which can be viewed on ProQuest, before concluding with some points on literary reputation. Temple had a rather interesting life, as you'll see in the timelines on the slide. The main thing to know is that he twice served as England's ambassador to the Dutch Republic, between 1668 and 1670, and again after a brief period of retirement between 1674 and 1679. While he was abroad, Temple negotiated the Triple Alliance in 1668, the marriage of Mary Stuart and William of Orange in 1677, and the Treaty of Nijmegen between France and the Dutch Republic in 1678. After he returned from the United Provinces in 1679, Temple was appointed to the Privy Council, but 2 years later he was sacked by Charles II in the aftermath of the exclusion crisis. Temple lived out the rest of his life in retirement, and in 1689 he took on a young Irishman called Jonathan Swift as his secretary. Yes, that is the Jonathan Swift, the one who goes on to write Gulliver's Travels. Temple died a decade later at the age of 71. During his political career, he turned down the position of Secretary of State about as far as he could realistically get on four separate occasions. Temple's life informed and shaped a diverse literary output that sold well, both in England and in continental Europe. Temple engaged with a variety of different genres, from poetry and pamphlets to memoir and medicine. By the year of his death, 70 different editions of Temple's work had been published. You can find many of these on Ebo and Ebe. Only 29, that's just over 40%, were actually published in his homeland. The rest were printed in Europe. The first of the two books that I'm going to show you today is Temple's most famous, his Observations upon the United Provinces. This survey was written in the autumn of 1672, just a few months after the Dutch Republic had been overrun by the forces of the French King Louis XIV. A year previously, Temple had been in effect fired as England's ambassador to the Dutch Republic by King Charles II, and he had since been living in retirement. In the opening of the book, Temple famously described the United Provinces as the envy of some, the fear of others, and the wonder of all their neighbours. But in the next sentence, he stressed, "We have this summer past beheld the same state, almost ruined and broken to pieces in some few days, and by very few blows. With this pessimistic framework in mind, Temple goes on to offer his thoughts on Dutch history, Dutch governance, Northern Netherlands geography, the characteristics of the Dutch people, the religious framework of the Republic, trade, the raising of taxes, and the reasons behind the chaos of 1672. Temple packed his observations with all sorts of wonderful insights into daily life in the United Provinces, such as the fact that the de facto leader of the Dutch Republic, Johan de Witt, could easily be seen walking in the streets on foot and alone. His account was overwhelmingly sympathetic to the Dutch themselves, especially when compared to other efforts offered by English pamphleteers, such as the wonderfully titled Amsterdam and Her Other Hollander Sisters Put Out to Sea by Van Tromp, Van Dunk and Van Dump, which you can also read on Ebo if you so wish. This publication, which was first printed during the First Anglo-Dutch War, dissected the Hollander into 12 parts to condemn, and I quote, their cowardliness, their pride, and their mad practice of drunkenness, end quote, amongst other vices. In his observations, Temple was much more sympathetic to the Dutch than this and other polemical pamphlets. The detailed and discriminating insights of the observations has ensured that it features regularly in books on the Dutch Golden Age today. The great Dutch historian Martin Praak has recently described it as probably the best contemporary analysis of Dutch society. But it is also worth stressing that the observations was a continental bestseller in its own time. By the end of 1676, it had gone through three English editions, four in Dutch and two in French, as well as two in German and a singular Italian edition. Few English statesmen enjoyed so much success on the European continent in the 17th century. The observations also left a lasting legacy on English descriptions of the Dutch Republic. At the beginning of his inaccurate description of the United Netherlands, William Carr admitted that after so great a man as William Temple, who has already published so full and incomparable a description of the states of the United Provinces, it is a vain presumption to attempt any further on that subject. The second and final book I'm going to talk to you about today is Temple's Memoirs of What Passed in Christendom, in which he offered an account of his activity as a diplomat between 1672 and 1679. This book was actually first published a lot later in 1691, almost 20 years after the observations had been published. Temple was something of a pioneer with his Memoirs of What Passed in Christendom. This is one of the first political memoirs by an Englishman to have been printed while their author was still alive. Temple published his memoirs, I believe, to outline his version of events, to offer lessons for the future, and to defend his close friend, William III, the Stadtholder of Holland, who had become King of England in 1688 in the Glorious Revolution. By 1691, when the memoirs was published, William III's popularity had plummeted. In the memoirs, William, one of the main characters of the piece, comes across as a charismatic figure and an effective military commander, i.e. an ideal man to lead a country. Temple himself blends three things together in his memoir: the events of the Franco-Dutch War, which William III fought in, the protracted discussions at the Peace of Nijmegen that ended this conflict, and Temple was there leading the English delegation, and finally incidents from his own personal life. These range from the intimate, like a conversation between Temple and William III in which the Prince of Orange asked for his help in finding a wife, to the frankly bizarre. For example, at one point in the memoirs, Temple recounts at length a chat that he had with the former governor of Dutch Brazil, Johan Moritz. Their conversation almost entirely revolves around a talking parrot that Moritz had met while he was in South America. The philosopher John Locke would later quote this incident in its entirety in a new edition of his Essay Concerning Human Understanding that was published in 1700, attributing it to an author of great note. The memoirs takes the reader right into the inner sanctum of early modern European diplomacy. This is best demonstrated by one of the more dramatic moments of the book, which comes during a tense exchange between Temple and King Charles II. Temple tells Charles that a king of England who will be the man of his people is the greatest king in the world, but if he will be something more, he is nothing at all. According to Temple, this is what happened next. Begin quote, "The king heard me all very attentively, but seemed a little impatient at first. Yet at last he said, I had reason. Laying his hand upon mine, he added, I will be the man of my people. Hollywood screenwriters, I think, would struggle to do better than this." As with the observations, the memoirs of what passed in Christendom sold well. By the end of 1692, the memoirs had been reprinted in London on an astonishing 4 further occasions. At the same time, Dutch translations were printed both in Rotterdam and Amsterdam, while Adrian Mutchins, also in The Hague, also published a French version. The memoirs also influenced other authors. In 1693, the Quaker William Penn published an essay on how he believed a European peace could be achieved through a continental parliament. And this text is regarded as an early forerunner to what eventually becomes the European Union. This is its final paragraph. To conclude, I have very little to answer in all this affair, because if it succeeds, I have so little to deserve. For this great king's example tells us it is fit to be done. And Sir William Temple's history shows us, by surpassing instance, that it may be done. And Europe, by her incomparable miseries, makes it necessary to be done. That my share is only thinking of it at this juncture and putting it into the common light for the priests and peace and prosperity of Europe. But unlike Temple's survey of the Golden Age, the memoirs was greeted with a noticeable backlash in print. In 1692, the diplomat Joseph August de Cross attacked how Temple had portrayed him in a bitter pamphlet that was published both in French and English. He promised that at some point would appear some memoirs which will divulge the truth. A response to this pamphlet, which was written by Temple's secretary Swift, proclaimed, "Let our monsieur scribble a cartload of books if he pleases. It is a sad and undeniable truth that it is in no power to injure no man breathing by them, but only his bookseller." While it was well written, this rebuttal was not quite a knockout blow, though. In February 1693, the politician Charles Hatton told his brother that Sir William Temple's reply to Lacrosse had injured his fame more than Lacrosse ever could have done. In a third pamphlet, which you can also read on Ebo, an anonymous lover of truth offered their thoughts on the debate. The author of Reflections Upon Two Pamphlets condemned de Cross's attack, arguing that his pamphlet was only designed to banter fools or children. And yet it had been written by a man, who had lost all respect to the public. But for all their criticism of de Cross, the lover of truth also attacked Swift's reply. And I quote, "Whatever the intention may have been of the writer, or in considering the bookseller's profit by making pass for an author whose name he knew would help it off better, yet I cannot but apprehend the example of it ill, and the consequences of it may be worse. Any man may be made a public defamer of himself at another man's pleasure." This little extract here, I believe, has a warning that echoes down the centuries. The publication of Temple's memoirs of what passed in Christendom demonstrated both the opportunities and dangers of the political memoir. It was a popular book, that was useful for Temple in telling his own side of the story and promoting his friend William III. But in the backlash it inspired, it also showed the risks that publishing a political memoir could pose to someone's reputation. It is easy to see why so few of Temple's contemporaries followed his example. Now, Temple passed away in 1699, and it appears that he enjoyed a decent reputation for around a century after his death. A number of prominent political, cultural, and intellectual actors of the 17th and 18th centuries owned, read, and enjoyed his books. John Adams, Edmund Burke, King George III, Robert Hooke, Thomas Jefferson, Isaac Newton, Madame de Pompadour, Samuel Pepys, and Voltaire all had books by William Temple in their libraries. Boswell, who I mentioned earlier, his great friend Samuel Johnson, even said that William Temple was the first writer who gave cadence to English prose. Now, I'm sure that many of you will have heard of one of Johnson's other good friends, Adam Smith, the author of The Wealth of Nations, who was recently described by the governor of the Bank of England, former governor of the Bank of England, Mark Carney, as the author of the most purchased, often cited, and arguably least read book in economics, The Wealth of Nations. Smith spent over a decade of his life teaching at the University of Glasgow. He lectured not only on economics, but also on ethics, law, and language. And in a talk on rhetoric, which he delivered on Friday, the 3rd of December, 1762, he declared, according to one of the notes of his attendees, "The difference in style arising from the character of the author, I endeavoured to illustrate by comparing the styles of two celebrated English writers, Swift and Sir William Temple. The one is an example of the plain style and the other of a simple one. Both are very good writers. Swift, as I observed, is remarkable for his propriety and precision. The other is not perhaps so very accurate, but he is as entertaining and much more instructive. This prominent standing, however, declined in the early decades of the 19th century. A notably strong blow to Temple's posthumous status was delivered by the Whig historian Thomas Babington Macaulay in a lengthy and acerbic assessment which first appeared in the Edinburgh Review in October 1838. Macaulay argued, Temple is one of those men whom the world has agreed to praise highly without knowing much about them. Neither as a writer nor as a statesman can we allow him any very high place. Temple's name has since faded into obscurity, but thanks to Ebe and Ebo, we can get a sense of just how popular he once was as a writer. One question I will leave you, therefore, is this. Just how many more authors like William Temple are out there? Thank you very much.